God's provision for suffering saints in the age of grace, an age during which we're walking by faith according to God and not by sight. Paul says in Romans 16:25, "Now to him that is able, or is of power, to establish or stabilize you according to my good news and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began." Something is changing when it comes to God's provision for suffering saints. And this will be taking place. We'll be witnessing it, in a sense, during this age of grace. Are we to pray? Yes, Paul said, pray without ceasing. Be overly anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, underline these next two words, with thanksgiving. With thanksgiving. Now, when you pray, and you want something to take place in your life, if you were a kingdom saint with the king present, the king promised, the king on the scene, and you were told to ask anything you want, it'll be done to you, it would be done. But when you pray in the age of grace, and we are to pray, we're to pray with thanksgiving. Let our request be made known unto him and pray with thanksgiving. But are we to pray with thanksgiving that he promised he would do it? Are we to pray with thanksgiving that we're going to get what we're praying for? Not at all. What is our thanksgiving about then? Trust. Trust that he knows what he's doing. And he's going to do it whether you're praying or not. He knows precisely what he's going to do, and we're going to see that as we move ahead here. The questions we've asked, is God glorified in the rule and reign of his son today? Is the king present? Through the prayer of faith, that was Israel's prayer. Or is God utilizing believers' prayers today that he might be glorified through the faith of the inwardly strengthened suffering saint? Where does he strengthen today, according to the Apostle Paul? Inwardly, to abide through whatever situation comes our way. Why? Because you're going to suffer the same things the world suffers, folks. Look around. If we're honest with ourselves, we have the same things happening in our families and with our loved ones and to ourselves that the world has happening to them today. And at the same rate, at the very same rate, we get sick at the same rate, we recover at the same rate, we do not recover at the same rate, and we die at the very same rate. There's nothing different. Now, your lifestyle choices can have a bearing on your health. But it's not because God has said you're a believer, you're just going to live to 400. Is God utilizing believers' prayers today that he might be glorified through the faith of the suffering saint? How is your faith exercised through your prayer life? Thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. God knows all about it. We said, do we pray to... Is the purpose of our prayers to call God's attention to our problem? Do we really think that he's off doing something else with someone else, concerned about some other things until we pray to let him know we've got a problem, and then he turns around and, oh, indeed, he does have a problem. What am I going to do about that? Or did God know about it long before you knew about it? You don't pray to call God's attention to something. He's already known about it. He's omniscient. Then what's your prayer life for? For his benefit? So he might become aware of something you have? Or for your benefit to exercise your trust in him in all things. It's given for our benefit. That's why it's the peace of God shall guard your hearts and your minds. It's the peace of God that you have as you exercise your trust that he knows all things. Nothing's escaped him. You can rely upon him, but what if somebody dies or what if the sickness remains? Does he not know about it? Is it truly to be better to be there than to be here? Or do we not take him at his word there? We'd rather be here. If it's truly better to be there than it is to be here, don't worry about not recovering. I think these finite minds cannot grasp being absent from here. I think the flesh has a death grip on the flesh, and we hold on to life here and our existence here with everything we have. And we'll do better than that. Why, we'll develop some religious structure where we can all come. We might put a higher steeple on it so we can get closer to God. We might take the prayers into the prayer tower so that they're that much closer to God. And if we have the right man that we would think is the power of God. Didn't they say that with Simon the sorcerer? This man is the great power of God. They thought if they could just get to Simon the sorcerer, why, he could reach God on their behalf. You know how many people there are today that think if they can just reach the church, if they can just get in those doors so they can come forward to what they've been told is an altar, if they can just reach that pastor, why, he's got a closer connection with God. Static on your lines, not static on his. He's got the direct shot. There's a cell tower that he's got with God, and he can reach him all the time. If we can get to that pastor and get him praying on our behalf, why, how can God refuse the pastor? Guess who's dwelling in you if you're a believer today? God, the Holy Spirit is inside you. He's making intercession for you according to the will of God. Do you need the pastor? No. Do you need people all praying the same thing at the same time? No. Do you need a 24-hour persistence line, as I'd call it, so that God just gets so tired of all the begging that he's just going to give in and give you your desire but to get you off his back? No. That worked with mom sometimes. Some of our moms were too wise. Mine was. She said, you bring your friend when you ask, and it's an automatic no. I learned to go by myself and get the no without my friend and not be embarrassed. Folks, there's a difference in the age of grace. What is that difference? It's strength made perfect in weakness, not strength made perfect in the elimination of the suffering situations. Look at 2 Corinthians 12:9. Paul, the apostle of grace, Paul said, unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given. Paul was the apostle appointed to that office of being the apostle of the Gentiles. He said, if you've heard of the dispensation committed unto me, most people haven't. They think all the Bible's written about them, but they're not building arks and they're not carrying their sacrifices to the temple. It's not all about you. Which part is about you? The part that was delivered to you by your apostle, the apostle of the Gentiles, the apostle Paul. And he said unto me, because Paul was praying for deliverance, physical deliverance. What was God's answer in the age of grace? My grace is sufficient for you, Paul. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Now, if we're weak, if you're suffering, if you're going through a trial, a tribulation in your life, and you're praying for God to take it away, but God's telling you that his will is that his strength may be made perfect in your weakness. What are you praying? I don't want your will to be done in my life. I don't want your strength to be made perfected in my weakness. I want you to take my weakness away. I want your strength to be perfected in my strength. Did Paul catch on? Did Paul get what God was telling him, what the ascended Christ was telling him? Most gladly, therefore, will I, next word, rather glory in my recoveries, healings, in my what? Infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. You see, God would strengthen Paul inwardly so that Paul would be able to sustain whatever was happening to him outwardly. And Paul could put that strength, inward strength of his, on display to a world going through the same things. I don't think nearly as drastic as Paul underwent. And Paul could put his hope on display, which was not this world, this life. It was the new body. It was being delivered from these suffering circumstances by being given a new body. But you see, we have that opportunity. You're going to have some things happen to you. If they've not already, they will. Live long enough and you'll see that happen to unbelievers alike. You're going to have people that you love pass on. You're going to have illness. You're going to have sickness. You're going to have things begin to happen to your bodies that you don't like, you don't desire. Otherwise, we'd have no one graduating from a school or university and having DR in front of their name. It wouldn't be necessary. because God would take it all away. But we have doctors today, and guess who needed one? Our Apostle Paul had Dr. Luke with him all the time. Not one of the 12, by the way. Sometimes we often confuse Luke with one of the 12. No, he wasn't. Paul had Dr. Luke with him all the time. And I imagine Dr. Luke was of great comfort to our apostle in all those situations. Can you imagine Paul a day and a night in the sea and having to undergo that? How many times was he beaten with 40 stripes less one? We can't imagine that. When Paul was stoned to death, do you think maybe a few stitches, a few dressings were needed for that? I don't know, but I know he had Dr. Luke with him. And we have doctors with us today, and guess who you're going to find at the offices of those doctors? Unbelievers and believers alike. They're all there. Paul caught on to what God was doing in this age of grace. Paul said, "Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me." Find me a testimony time such as this in our churches across the land today. Paul's threefold antidote to suffering. Remember your prospect of glory. He gives it to us in Romans 8:18. "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time..." Now, God dealt with the people in past time, Israel, according to those signs, miracles, marvels, wonders, and the prayer of faith saved the sick. "But I reckon that the sufferings of this present time," Paul writes, "are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." 2 Corinthians 4:17, "For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory." If you knew for a fact, if you knew it to be true, if Jesus Christ could walk in here today and look at you, no matter what suffering circumstances or circumstance you're living through right now, and he could say, "Guess what? What you're going through right now is light. It's light affliction because it's just for a moment. Just the briefest part of your eternal life. This existence here in this, on this earth right now. Work is, if that's working for you, a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory." Would you take him at his word if he told you that? He's told you that. There it sits. Is his word any less true because you don't hear it audibly, but you can read it and see it? He's telling you that the things you've gone through, the things you are going through, the things you will go through if you're a believer and have a patience of hope, are working for you a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory. "While we look not at the things which are seen," 2 Corinthians 4:18, "but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle, this earthly tent, were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." That's hope. That's hope. We can put that hope on display while we're suffering. The folks who have no knowledge of our hope, they think everything they have, everything they are, everything they ever will be, resides right here in the moment with what is. And so when things come their way and not the verdict, but it's almost like the sentence, when the diagnosis is made, they fall to pieces. Because it's all about here for those folks. Paul's saying, no, there's some way that you're going to be strengthened inside as you go through these things. So you can put your hope on display to those folks who know nothing about your hope, that they might learn of your hope. How are you strengthened inside? Does God reach down inside the believer and play a string that's never been played? And all of a sudden you just don't feel weak anymore. You feel strong. Is that how he does it? Mm-mm. Nope. How does he do it? Through his word that tells you about your hope. That's your strength. His word tells you what he's done for you. His word tells you what your future is. His word tells you don't look at things on this earth. Keep your thoughts trained there. This is only temporary. And if we can do that, that strength comes because of that word. It's the word of God that does the work of God in the believer that takes in the word of God and believes that word of God. And prayer was given to you for that very purpose, so you could express your trust and your thankfulness in what he's done in your times of distress. That's what your prayer life is about. Not to get God's attention, not to get God to do something he'd never planned to do. That isn't the purpose of your prayer life. It was given that you might have peace as you express your trust in him in all things. Remember the prayer of the Holy Spirit. Likewise, the Spirit helpeth our infirmities. The Holy Spirit's inside you if you're a believer. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because that Holy Spirit is making intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Now, if you're a grace age saint and the Holy Spirit is inside you, making intercession for you according to the will of God, is your prayer life given to you that you might change God's mind or get him to do something he had no intention of doing? Calling his attention to your problem? Not at all. Prayer was given to you that you might express your trust. And you keep expressing your trust in him in all things. Whatever happens. You know, as Christ prayed, not my will, but thine be done. And when you trust him for all things, that's a peace that can begin to control your thought life. I'm going to speed through some of these because I want you to see this. If we hope for that we see not, if we hope for something we can't really see, then do we with patience wait for it? This is what our patience of hope is all about. This is what our patience of hope is all about, for folks. It's not about screaming, crying, gathering people, fix it, fix it, fix it. It's about what we have to look forward to when we're there in that new body that's ours and that far more exceeding eternal weight of glory that God has in mind for the suffering saints. He's left here in the midst of suffering situations. That's us, that we might put our hope on display to others. Your patient endurance through suffering is a way of demonstrating your hope. When your hope is put on display in the midst of your suffering, that brings glory to God. His strength is made perfect in your weakness. Paul caught on. Therefore, 2 Corinthians 12:10, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am outwardly weak, then I am inwardly strong. Do you see it? He that searcheth the heart knows what's the mind of the Spirit, who's making intercession for you according to the will of God. Know what the will of God for you today is. And the will of God for all grace age believers is that his strength be perfected in your weakness. If you know that, you won't be wondering why you're going through the same situations that the world undergoes. Our light affliction. Prayer was never given to change God's perspective of our greater preference. Prayer was given to change our perspective of God's greater purpose. And God's greater purpose is not to strengthen our faith by altering our circumstances. God's greater purpose is to allow us to demonstrate our faith today as we remain strong in spite of our circumstances. Hopefully you can see the difference in the two. Prayer was never given to bring God into alignment with our wants. Prayer was given to bring us into alignment with God's will. Prayer was provided that our trust be given expression. I don't know how else to say it. Prayer was given that our trust might be given expression. But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Here's some good news for you. You can write this one down and tack it up on the refrigerator. Well, don't tack it. Tape it. Ephesians 3. Beginning with verse 20, how will he know what to do if I don't tell him what to do in prayer or ask him what to do? How will he know what I want? How will he know what I'm thinking about this circumstance? Paul tells us, now to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above. Paul didn't say, like he did with a far more exceeding eternal weight of glory. Paul could have said, now unto him that is able to do above all that we ask. Paul didn't say, now unto him that is able to do abundantly above. Look how he wants to magnify on the concept so you'll get it. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or even think, according to the power that worketh where? In us. What is that power working in us? It's the praying Holy Spirit who's praying on your behalf each and every moment of each and every day according to the will of God. As we take in his word, as we study that word, and as we're grown up by that word, we begin to understand what he's done for us, where our hope lies, what he has in store for us, and we begin to put less and less confidence in what happens here in this world. And as that takes place and divine viewpoint begins to replace human viewpoint, what a way to let God know that you catch it. What a way to let God know that you got a handle on what he's doing in this age of grace. What a way to express to him that you trust him in all things, not my will, but thine will be done. That's why prayer was given to believers in the age of grace. Now we're going to move on.